One of the things we were talking about last week is starting to change our thinking and adopting the mind of Christ and start thinking like kingdom mindset, you know. You know, we learned that our old nature is dead, has been crucified. You know, we the old me is dead, and now I no longer live, but Christ lives in me, and he wants to live through me. See, he doesn't live in you only to stay down there locked up and quiet so that he's your ticket to heaven. He lives in you so that he can live through you. And you got to ask yourself sometimes, is Christ really living through you every day? You know, is Christ the one who is interacting with your wife, or is it your old selfish you? Is Christ the one raising up your children, because he's living in you to live through you? You didn't think about that way before? So Titus chapter 3, verse 5, I'm gonna read from 5 through 7. It says, he saved us not because of the righteous things we had done. So not because you were so good, you know, but because of his mercy. He washed away our sins, giving us a new birth and a new life through the Holy Spirit. He generously poured out the Spirit upon us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Because of his grace, he declared us righteous and gave us confidence that we will inherit eternal life. If you realize something about these scriptures right here, it's all about him. It's everything about what he did, not about what you did. It's not about your past, who you were, what you did, what your mistakes were. It's all about what he did. And he's telling you, you know, he's the one who saved you. Not because you were goody tissues, or maybe some of you didn't even have a chance at being goody tissues, you know. But it's not because any of that, but because of his mercy. He gave you new birth. He gave you new life. He gave you the Holy Spirit. Because of his grace, he declared you righteous. See, what I want to talk about today is another component, another key component to growing and being transformed, to being equipped. Last week we talked about we need to understand that we're dead, Christ lives in us. Our new nature is not sinful. Our new nature is good because we are in him. Okay? Today we're talking about the power of humility, because I believe humility has the power and is the key to be able to change and be transformed and be able to grow in that ever-growing process, you know, that never stops, that keeps you, like Paul said, you know, pressing on towards the goal, on and on, day after day. So true humility is not the absence of confidence, but the exaltation of God. And I say that because the world and the church have a lot of times defined humility as weakness, as lack of confidence, or even as lack of resources or finances. But humility in the Bible has a completely different meaning. Jesus was humble, and he wasn't weak. He was confident. He knew who he was. He was 100% God, 100% man. And he walked in the authority that the Father had given him. So humility, true humility, is not the absence of confidence, but the exaltation of God. And if you realize everything we just read in Titus, who is it pointing to? His grace, his mercy, his what he did for us. He took our sins away. He declared us righteous. It's everything that he does. So you are a righteous person. Say, I am righteous. How does that feel? You know, to some of you, might feel really good. To some of you, it feels a little uncomfortable. Who knows? Depends where you're at, right? But if you say, I am righteous, it could sound like you're arrogant, right? But if your heart knows this and it's coming out of the exaltation of God, then it's true humility, not arrogance, because you know it is not you. You know, Paul says in Corinthians and in Romans, and he said, there's nothing that I can do to boast about myself, because it's only thing I could boast in is in the cross, in his cross, in what he did for me. So true humility is not the absence of confidence, but the exaltation of God. I am righteous, but it is because he made me righteous. And I am confident in him, but it's because he called me his son. He adopted me. Matthew 5:5, I'm going to read out of the New Living Translation. It says, God blesses those who are humble, for they will inherit the whole earth. Who wants to inherit the whole earth? I want to inherit the whole earth. You know what's in the earth? Silver and gold and diamonds and cattle and land and real estate and nations. It says, ask me and I will give you the nations. God says, ask me and I will give you the nations. Jesus called us to disciple nations, to make disciples. You know, I want the whole earth. You know, so far we got a foot here and we got a foot in Africa and we got somebody else's foot. You know, we don't have 3 feet. I was going to say, and we have another foot. That would be kind of weird. But we're setting stakes here. We're saying, you know, our stakes in Africa. We're saying our stakes in Mexico. Where else does God want to take us? You know, maybe he speaks to one of you to go to Afghanistan or, I don't know, maybe just a different state or something else. You know, he wants to give us the whole earth, the nations. But he can't trust us with the nations if there's pride in us. You know, you could do a word study on humility and pride, and you'll come up with so many scriptures in Proverbs where it talks about the danger of a prideful king. You know, it's dangerous to have a prideful king ruling. Why? Because a prideful king is insecure, and he has to squash everybody else to continue feeling royal, which is silly because he's already a royal. You know what I mean? So God couldn't trust you with the earth. God couldn't trust us with tremendous riches if there was pride in us, because the proud has so many identity issues. A prideful person has so many identity issues and so much lack of confidence, and they seem to be the most confident, sometimes arrogant. But in true reality, there's so much insecurity inside. The proud would think that they've conquered the earth themselves. This is not in my notes today, but if you go and read this story of Nebuchadnezzar, it is such a powerful story that describes exactly what we're talking about today. He's the king. He had an amazing kingdom, and he was like, he was the extreme, extreme, arrogant, prideful, you know, king. Like, he was like, look at me. It's all me. I am great. I am amazing, you know. And it was all rooted in self, in him. So that arrogance drove him crazy, you know. And then you see how God deals with him. But when he came out of his arrogance, he said, it's funny because he starts saying, like, I am so great. He, you know, after being crazy for 7 years, and losing his mind, he comes back to himself. He's sane again. He's restored. And he says again, he goes, I am awesome. My kingdom is awesome. But then he follows by saying it, but the God of heaven, the King of all kings, you know, it's because of him. So he understood at a whole nother level. He didn't talk bad about himself, but he acknowledged and recognized where it all came from and who was the source of that greatness and the source of his amazing kingdom and all of that, that it was God. So religion redefined humility, and when they were done, they stripped off all the identity too. Have any of you ever try to clean something and you end up cleaning too hard that you take the paint off? You know, you're like, oh, this is dirty. You know, this is my dad's story, but he says when he was young, you know, he had a body shop across the street from our house. He rented this lot and he painted cars. This is kind of like, I only have flashbacks of this. I don't really know. I don't really remember it fully. But he said the principal of my school had a beautiful black Crown Victoria, you know, and it was like an amazing, huge car, you know, back in the day. And they asked my dad if he would paint it for them, because my dad's mom worked at the school with the principal. It's the school where I grew up as well. So my dad's like, yeah, of course, you know, I'll paint your car. And it was a special place where it had gotten scratched and he had to repair it. And so he started buffing it, and he realized there was like this one spot and he just kept rubbing it and rubbing it and rubbing it. And after like about 5 minutes, he realized the spot was just getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And he had taken all the paint off of that section, and he had to repaint that whole part of the car again, you know. So it reminds me a little bit of what the church and religion does to us as Christians and children of God sometimes, you know. They talk to us so much about humility and a false humility that it ends up stripping away our identity in Christ, our royal identity, you know. So you end up believing you are nothing but the scum of the earth, a sinner saved by grace, and you stay there and never grow up to your place of royalty and your divine nature. Because you just think of yourself that you have to be humble, and Jesus was humble, and I must be humble and poor and weak and not confident. Because he resists the proud, right? And you think you're being prideful by knowing who you are in Christ. So that's a problem that religion has done, and that's something that we work really hard here in the Bible school to restore identity. One of the words that God spoke to us as a church is this would be a place where people's dignity would be restored. And not because of who they are, but because of Christ in them, because of their identity as sons and daughters, of princes and princesses. Does that make sense? Come with me to Philippians chapter 2 and verse 3. I believe there's a tension in humility, especially because of the definition that the world has given humility of weakness and lack or a humble person. Philippians 2, 3 says, I'm going to read all the way through verse 6, says, don't be selfish, don't try to impress others. This is the New Living Translation. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. Wow, this would revolutionize your life and your marriage if you remember to not just talk about everything that you're going through, but also listen to everything that they need to say, you know? Like, not, you know, and there's, do you guys know any of those people that just talk, and then they're done, and they go? Like, they never listen. You know, like, oh, well, I wanted to tell you also how I was doing, you know, or like, you know, and it's like, so it says, you know, think of others as better than yourself. Don't look out only for your own interest, but take an interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Jesus Christ had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. So what this is saying, you know, Jesus was God. But he didn't take that to crush others. He didn't take that to make himself above others. But he walked with them. He was with them. He put them first. He washed their feet. If you think about it, God washing your feet, that's pretty crazy, right? Because he's the one who deserves his feet washed by us. But it says that he came to serve, not to be served. Now, did that make him less? Did that make him weak? Did that make him not confident? No, right? Because he was God and he knew he was God. See, when you're so confident and so wrapped up in the Father's love, there's nothing you do or nothing anybody can say to you that will make you feel less. When we think of others better than ourselves, it doesn't mean we need to think bad of us. Instead, we think so highly of us that we bring others up to their divine nature, divine level. So, you know, some people take this scripture a little wrong, and, you know, and they think that thinking of, they, you know, they think, how can I think of others better than myself? And they're really not. Right? Like, honestly, I'm in a way better place than they are, right? Like, if you think about it that way, it might be a little hard to think of others better. I mean, you see, maybe you walk out and you see the drug addict and the homeless person that is just completely lost and in drugs and alcoholism, and the Bible's referring to them too, to think of them as better than yourself. And you're like, well, how can I think of them better than myself? You know, like I would have to think of myself way, way, way low to think of them better than myself. You know what I'm saying? You're seeing them with your earthly eyes and you think, okay, I got to be humble and I got to think of them better than myself. So that means that I have to think of myself like I'm like dirt. I'm like what comes out of the drainage. You know, like I am like so bad and so dirty and so sinful. And like I have to think of myself really low so that I can think of other people better than myself. And that's what humility has done to so many people. It's like, well, I really can't think much of myself because I need to think better of others than me. Because that's what it's saying. But you don't understand that this is kingdom talk. This is Christ's mind. And what it's saying here is that to be able to think of others better than yourself, you need to have the same attitude as Jesus. Jesus was God, and he knew he was God. So he didn't lower himself and thought lowly of himself. He knew he was God. So when he thought of others better and treated others as better than himself, he actually elevated them to their true calling and their true identity in Christ. And this is what actually makes the best prophets. Those that know who they are in Christ, they don't need to put others down, but instead they're able to see them how God sees them and say, you're better than that. You're called for great things. Actually, you know, you're called to be a blessing to others. You know, you're called to disciple nations. You're called to fund the kingdom of God. God has amazing plans for you. And how can they do that? Because they're so confident in who they are in Christ and their royal identity that they're able to speak and talk to others and bring them up to that level instead of having to put themselves down to see others better than themselves. You know what I mean? That's a father mentality where I'm not afraid to see you higher, and that doesn't mean that I need to be lower. It's like we have the first level, and then we have the basement. And a lot of Christians think they need to live in the basement so they can treat others better. When in fact, God has called us all to the penthouse. And has called you up to bring others up to the penthouse too. Does that make sense? So humility is our confidence. You know, true humility is when we're actually glorifying God and we're confident in who we are in Him that we can bring others up. The prideful actually have to put others down to continue to make themselves feel worthy or good. Now, it says have the same attitude that Jesus had. You know, I think back in the 90s and the 2000s, you know, some of us wore those WWJD, what would Jesus do? You know, the wristbands and stuff. And that's actually a pretty good reminder, because having the same attitude as Jesus had, that's what we're called to have. See, Jesus was the lion and the lamb, both. One, right? One seems ferocious, aggressive, and the other one seems, pretty mellow and calm. See, but he was both. And we need to learn to be a lion on the outside and a lamb on the inside. And that's what he was. You know, there's some lions here in the room too, right? And those lions, you know what makes the best lions? Because they're lambs on the inside. They're tender, you know. They're those soft teddy bears. So they're strong and confident. But when inside of them there's humility, you know, and they're humble, they're confident, but the inside they're lambs. They're soft. So they're not tearing people apart. They're building people up. And they're strong. It's like that lion from Narnia. You know, it makes you want to hug him, doesn't it? It's like a lion. You know, it'd be scary, but that lion, you just want to snuggle with him. So you have to learn to be a lion on the outside, a lamb on the inside. Same thing with fathers and sons. You know, we say we're a church where we want spiritual mothers and fathers. You know, we want everybody to become a spiritual father, but when I've taught about this, I said you can't be a good father if you're not a son. Because the moment you stop being a son, you can no longer be a good father. Jesus was both. He was a son. He had an amazing relationship with his father, and that allowed him to be a father to his disciples, a father to those around him, a father to us. Even the Bible refers to him as that. And this is not a theology thing like, oh, wait, I thought the father and Jesus was the son, and how can you call him? No, the Bible even refers to Jesus because it's a spiritual picture of him fathering us. So Jesus was both forever father, forever son, forever father. So the only way you can be a good father is continue to be a son. And a lot of people think that when they start being fathers, they have to stop being sons. Or maybe your earthly father is not even there, but you don't realize that your relationship with your heavenly father is what will make you a good father. So you need to learn to be both, lion and the lamb, father and son. Deal with each other in humility. Humility keeps you teachable and able to grow and learn. So this is where I'm getting to, is how powerful humility is, because it keeps you teachable and able to grow like clay. We're the clay, he's the potter. You don't want to be a piece of clay that gets hard and dry. You always be fresh, always be in his hands, always let him mold you. I love how Sean says it. He says that keeping a beginner's mind, a beginner's heart, right? Something like that. What does that mean? That you don't approach things as if you knew it all, but with an open heart of what can I learn out of this? Oh, I've heard about humility before. You know that. What can you learn now? You know, what new thing could God speak to you? Because the Word of God is everlasting. He's the everlasting God. So his word has always something new, something fresh, something for that season and that place where you are today. So humility keeps you teachable and able to grow. Pride hardens your heart, and it doesn't allow you to grow anymore. 1 Peter 5:5 says, "In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders. And all of you, dress yourselves in humility as you relate to one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." We can't grow. Well, check this out. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Here's something God showed me. The humble, it's saying that the humble can grow because of the grace of God. God gives favor to the humble as well, right? If you're not humble, you don't have that grace. And grace is the power of God. So what that tells you is that when you're not humble and you're in pride, the only way you can grow and move forward is in your own strength. And don't want to do anything in your own strength. You will strive and you will live a life works-based, performance-based. But you want the supernatural power of God behind everything that you do. That's his grace for it. And that requires us to stay humble. You know why? Because humility also draws us close to him, draws us to our relationship to our Father. Pride pushes us away. Pride says, I could do it myself. As a matter of fact, one of the lack of prayer or no prayer in somebody's life is a huge indicator of arrogance that says, I can do it on my own. I don't need anybody else. I don't need God. But when you're humble, you get the grace, the power of God to do those things. And guess what? It's so much easier, so much better, so much powerful. And guess what? Also, it always keeps pointing back to him and not you. Amen? Jim Richards says, we can't grow while covering our tracks, and we can't deal with how it is if we're consumed with how it looks. You know, we've said that some of our greatest victories are also hidden in our most vulnerable moments. You know, so when we are humble, we're able to deal with the things that are not supposed to be there or the things that are not totally lined up instead of being worried and prideful about how it looks. So humility isn't thinking less of you, but thinking about yourself less. Did I confuse you? So humility is not thinking of you little, weak. It's just thinking about yourself less often. And that's why a lot of people confuse it, because they don't know which one it is. Humility keeps you thinking more about Him than about yourself. Amen? So humility is a powerful, powerful key in our growth, in our training, in our ever conquering the next thing that God has for us. And that's what He wants for all of us. You know, as we come in and we're like, we want to be trained, we want to be equipped, we want to, you know, fulfill our destiny and our calling. One of the biggest things is we need to keep always a beginner's heart. You know, like Sean says, a heart that is open to learn and to grow and to look inside and say, Holy Spirit, you want to deal with this? Okay, let's deal with it. Let's not wait another year. Let's not wait another 10 years. There's a little pride inside of me that I don't want that to keep me from growing. I don't want that to keep your grace, your power from my life. So let's get that out of the way. You know, you cannot, you know, a lot of people's, their fear to be humble because they don't want to be humiliated, or they've been humiliated before and they're afraid to be humble and have an open heart. But you cannot humiliate a humble person. Amen. If you learn anything at all, give the Lord a hand. God is so good. This is our key, our next key for growth. You know, it's preparing the foundation. Knowing our new nature, knowing who we are in Him, and keeping an open heart, keeping humble all the time, because otherwise we're going to be fighting against ourselves with pride, you know, to grow. You know, we all want to grow. We all want to go to the next place God has us. But we will be our biggest enemies if we keep pride in our hearts, because it will not allow us to change, grow, or receive, or be fathered. Amen. So, Father, I just thank You this morning for Your word. I thank You, Father, for the anointing that is in this place that just speaks truth to our hearts, that it shows us the areas in our lives, in our marriages, or with our children, or at work, or at church, where we've kept pride in our hearts and it's harmed us, and it's prevented us from growing. It's prevented us from going to the next place, or where pride has stolen from us Your power and Your grace to overcome things and situations in our lives. So I just pray right now, God, that You would show us in those areas and those things, Lord, where you want a humble spirit, a humble attitude before You, God, so that we can grow, so that Your grace and Your favor would be all around us, and that we can always go ahead and point back to You in those victories, that we can say we are Your victory story. We are the story of Your victories, of Your redemption, of the victory in the cross. We are that victory. And we just thank You for that in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen.